Good evening, dear colleagues and friends, dear participants of our conference, and especially Anna. Welcome back to the keynote lecture at our conference on 500 years of the Reformation. Thank you for coming to this evening event. I have the honor and privilege to chair this lecture and to welcome and introduce our distinguished speaker, Professor Susanne Heschel, who has kindly agreed to present her views on the theological benefits and problems in the Protestant-Jewish relationship. We are honored and delighted to have won such an eminent scholar and public intellectual for this keynote lecture. And on behalf of the organizers and of all of us, I would like to thank you most sincerely, Susanne, for having accepted our invitation and for having joined us here in Jerusalem. Susanne Heschel is the Eli Black Professor of Jewish Studies at Dartmouth College, as probably most of you know. Her rich scholarship as a historian focuses on Jewish-Christian relations in Germany during the 19th and 20th centuries, the history of biblical scholarship, the history of anti-Semitism, and the history of Jewish scholarship on Islam in the modern period. Among her numerous publications, please let me emphasize two pioneering monographs which are at the very core of what we will be discussing during the coming days, and which have inspired many of us. I personally can certainly say that my own thought and work in the field would have been virtually impossible without the profound insights these two books and Susanne's scholarship in general have achieved with regard to the history of Jewish scholarship on Christianity and to the history of Christian antisemitism. Susanne's book, Abraham Geiger and the Jewish Jesus, which appeared in 1998 with the University of Chicago Press, won a National Jewish Book Award, was translated into German, and won the Abraham Geiger Prize of the Geiger Kolleg in Potsdam. Based on the insights of post-colonial theory, it has revolutionized our understanding of Wissenschaftliches Judentum in the 19th century by reinterpreting the latter's approach to Christianity as a self-confident challenge to Protestant hegemonic constructions of Judaism, rather than as an apologetic enterprise. Susanne's book, The Aryan Jesus, Christian Theologians and the Bible in Nazi Germany, was published by Princeton University Press in 2008 and has been equally pioneering in analyzing the anti-Semitic ideology underlying much of German Protestant biblical scholarship during and prior to the Nazi period. The author of more than 100 articles, she has also edited and co-edited several books, which I will mention only a few, on being a Jewish feminist, moral grandeur and spiritual audacity essays of Abraham Joshua Heschel, Betrayal, German Churches and the Holocaust, Insider, Outsider, American Jews and Multiculturalism, and Holocaust Scholarship, Personal Trajectories and Professional Interpretations, among others with Christopher Browning. Susanne has held a number of visiting professorships. In 1992 to 1993, I have to say proudly, she was the Martin Buber Visiting Professor of Jewish Religious Philosophy at the University of Frankfurt. She has also taught at the University of Edinburgh, the University of Cape Town, and Princeton University. She was a Rockefeller Fellow at the National Humanities Center in the late 1990s and received a number of other prestigious fellowships, among others from the Wissenschaftskolleg in Berlin in 2011 and 12. And she received 4 honorary doctorates from universities in the United States, Canada, and in Germany. Susanne's current main project, which is not going to be discussed today, I guess, is devoted to the Jewish fascination with Islam, the history of Jewish scholarship on Islam and its impact on modern Jewish self-understanding. And I've just learned that the first book is coming out in German in a few weeks, entitled Jüdischer Islam, Islam und jüdisch-deutsche Selbstbestimmung. But tonight, her talk is entitled Is God a Virgin? Theological Benefits and Problems in the Protestant-Jewish Relationship. We're very much looking forward.
Thank you so much, Christian Wiese. It's wonderful always to be with you, and of course I've learned so much from you and your work over the years. We've known each other for many decades, and we have a lot to reminisce about, I think. Also, if we track some of the changes from the days when we first met in Germany, how our Jewish-Christian discussions have changed over time, which is something else we should be discussing. I would like to express my gratitude and that of all of the participants here to Hebrew University for hosting us, and of course to the University of Frankfurt, especially the Leo Beck Institute that's organized this conference in such a wonderful way, and also to the Evangelical Church of Germany for what it means to us to have you here as a co-sponsor of this conference. And to my many colleagues and friends, it's wonderful to be with you this evening. I will just like to start though by saying that when I was first invited, anybody hear me, by the way? Yes, so when I was first invited to give this lecture, I thought, what a wonderful opportunity. There's so much history to discuss, so much theology to debate. And then something happened, and I have to just mention this because it's hanging very much over us. So at the time Christian Visa invited me, there was hope in the air. Society was progressing in wonderful directions. Obama was our president, and we were celebrating daily. And then there was a crash. Something terrible happened. The dignity of the office was sullied. The concern for human beings seems to be lost. You know what kinds of analogies we speak of in the United States. Germany is on our minds every day. So I'm not here tonight, of course, to talk about that. I'm not here to talk about movements of white nationalism and neo-Nazism and their collaboration with the evangelical right in the United States, as well as with the radical Jewish right. But I have to say it. The Jewish Defense League was asked to come to defend the Jews of Whitefish, Montana, a tiny town with just a few Jewish families, under threat from Richard Spencer, the leader of the white nationalist neo-Nazi movement in America, who came to that town of Whitefish and bought a house and became a presence and threatened them physically and verbally. And the Jewish Defense League said, we're not going to go to Whitefish, Montana, because we align ourselves as the Jewish Defense League with the white supremacists. I heard Richard Spencer say, you Jews, you don't want to open your doors to Israel to anybody, and we want a white Christian America. There are alliances that are taking place that are very frightening and very depressing. And it's something that is on my mind every day, every hour. And I can't begin an academic talk, even, without at least mentioning to you that my heart is very heavy. And I believe very strongly that those of us with a commitment to religion, whatever our faith may be, or with a commitment to scholarship, we each have a very strong imperative right now, at the very least, to speak about what's going on. And then there is much more to be done beyond speaking. But let's begin with that. Now, let me just say that my talk this evening, I'm going to put aside my role as a historian, my work as a historian, and instead take a little bit of a different approach, what I don't know what to call it, perhaps a cultural studies, or more perhaps a literary approach, but I want to do a bit of an overview over some of the issues that concern me and that I think should be of concern to all of us. I want to talk about positive teachings, and I also want to pinpoint some issues of theological danger, problems that strike me in Protestantism and Judaism. I guess I'm going to end up talking more about Protestant attitudes toward Judaism than Jewish attitudes toward Protestantism, but I also want to suggest that we might ask new kinds of questions. And finally, I want to conclude by saying that we do have much in common, Protestants and Jews, both in terms of the dilemmas that we face and also ways forward. And I mean by dilemmas, political dilemmas, theological, philosophical dilemmas. Should you ask why a conference on Protestantism and Judaism would be taking place in a moment when the world seems to be bursting with hatreds of all kinds, let me cite Frantz Fanon, who wrote in his book Black Skin, White Masks, that his Antillean philosophy professor warned him once, whenever you hear anyone abuse the Jews, pay attention, because he's talking about you. Identities, I will argue, are not stable. They bleed from theology to politics, from Christian to Jewish. I want to argue that Protestantism, in calling for a return to Christian origins, was a tool to regulate reading practices. It wasn't just about sola scriptura, the text. And what I mean by Protestantism, of course, covers a wide range not only of Christian denominations, but also of political commitments, from a theology of return to a glorious apostolic age, to the embrace of National Socialism, but also to the embrace of the Civil Rights Movement of the 1960s. And throughout these moments, Jews always stood at the center of the Protestant imagination. And I must pause by telling you that I grew up with this. That is, I grew up in the home of a wonderful Jewish theologian. I hope you know his work, Abraham Joshua Heschel. But many of his closest friends were themselves Protestants. And I have a very strong feeling in my heart for the relationships that my father had with Reinhold Niebuhr, with a Martin Luther King, with William Sloan Coffin, and with so many others. Mahmoud Darwish, in his poem, 11 Stars Over Andalusia, writes, quote, "I want from love only the beginning. The first glimpse, the first kiss, the moments of fantasizing what this new, unexplored person is really like. This is a glorious moment for all of us. Perhaps the longing for the first moments of love is part of the impulse of the Protestant quest for a return to Christian origins that leads inevitably to Jesus, Paul, and the apostles, all Jews. Longing, of course, also shapes the Jewish religious imagination, as Sidra Ezrahi has written about. But Christianity does not play the same sort of theological role in Judaism as Judaism does in Christianity. Now, at the outset, Protestantism was a liberal moment, the priesthood of all believers. That was its motto. It was also the phrase used by Jewish liberals. Abraham Geiger used it as the watchword, of the Pharisees. By the 19th century, millenarianism was gone, supernaturalism was rejected, and Protestants wanted the faith of Jesus rather than the religion about Jesus, so they said. Jews followed a similar pattern, and our millennialism, twinned with nationalism, has been revived with a passion in recent decades. Now, Protestantism's promise is that it freed Christians from the constraints of the institutional and political hierarchies of Catholicism to a diffusion of religious authority to all. Each person reads and understands scripture for him or herself. As the African-American writer Richard Wright says in his novel, The Outsider of 1953, he says, "Religion was once an affair of the church. It is now in the streets, in each man's heart." So for the Reformation, the importance of the past was linked to the imminent present, that which was about to unfold. And this past was available in an immediacy for each person, not through a corpus of commentary, but from the text itself, from sola scriptura, and through each person's own relationship to the Bible. The Bible, which was God's word, not man-made religion, as Karl Barth thundered in 1919. But making the Bible accessible to a mass of readers gave rise to an anxiety of regulating its reading practices. Medieval Christians rejected the corporeality of God, but Protestants helped God regain a body, Amos Funkenstein writes. For Luther, Christ is present in the wafer. His body is everywhere, at all times. In fact, a doctrine that has little scriptural basis. Zwingli, in the 1529 Marburg disputation with Luther, pointed out, and I love this line, he pointed out, Zwingli, that Jesus also said, "I am the vine." Meaning, of course, Zwingli meant that not every leaf has the presence of Jesus. Such statements should be taken as merely symbolic, a human body. Jesus is surely not present in plants. Rather, a body has a history, a biography, and Jesus' biography was the biography of a Jew. If Protestantism's intention was a return to the apostolic age, it hit a precarious problem. In returning to beginnings, Protestants found themselves in the world of Jews. This led to actual encounters with Jews, some positive, negative, and we'll hear about that over the course of the next two days. But it also led to a new role for Jews in the Protestant imagination that threatened the boundaries between the two religions. Now, Heike Overman argued that the 16th century marks, quote, a new peak of anti-Judaism. Alison Kuder sees Jewish-Christian relations, rather, as metaphors for larger questions of boundaries. Quote, "From the Renaissance through the Enlightenment, Jewish-Christian encounters became a key element in defining attitudes toward personal, national, and religious identity. These were debates that occurred over questions of language, history, religion, morality, and truth in general. That is, theology provides an ideology, but political contingency regulates the transition into deed. Stressing the importance of microhistory, Jonathan Lucan points out that expulsion efforts against Jews in Protestant areas, for example, only succeeded when the constellation of local politics was favorable. Now, our concern at this conference should not only be relations between Christians and Jews as affected by Protestantism, but also the images, fantasies, anxieties, and wishes that shaped the imagination. What are the imagined Jews and Judaisms of Protestantism? Scholars examining conversion during the 16th century, including Michael Ragusis, Jeffrey Schulson, Alison Crudier, among others, note the emerging destabilization of Europe's Christian identity with a growing awareness of religious diversity, including pagan and magical elements, and also an awareness of Islam. Islam, which gained a presence both in the imagination and in the reality of Europe. The Shakespeare scholar Stephen Greenblatt writes that even as Columbus took possession of American natives for his monarch, so did Muslims take possession of European Christians for themselves and their rulers. Thousands were taken captive from Britain and Europe. And as we know, the presence of conversos deepened the anxieties as well as the growing intolerance of early modern regimes. What were the questions? Can a Jew really become a Christian? And note, of course, that Joseph Kaplan sees the same concern about Christian converts to Judaism. Can you, Christian, push the arrow to one? Okay. So these anxieties over the slipperiness of conversion, of Christian identity, were given expression in The Merchant of Venice, and I want to turn now to a few passages to illustrate this. We start with Antonio's sarcastic remark about Shylock. The Hebrew will turn Christian. He grows kind. Shylock's servant, Lancelot, moans, I am a Jew if I serve the Jew any longer. Being Christian may not be stable. There is Shylock, living in Venice, the alien within, a metaphor for the fear of this danger. Jewishness lurking within the Christian. The engine of anxiety, of course, is desire. The 2,000-year Christian wish that Christianity would be the object of Jewish desire, a wish that was thwarted by the reality of Jewish converts. Were they really Christian? The horror, you know what? Go back one. Sorry. The horror enacted in The Merchant of Venice is that not even baptism, not even conversion will erase the Jewishness of the Jew who converts to Christianity. And even worse, Christians may themselves be Judaized. Jewishness is the sinfulness within the Christian as expressed in John Donne's Holy Sonnet number 11, which you can see here. And I just read a couple of lines. Spit in my face, you Jews, and pierce my side. Buffet and scoff, scourge and crucify me, for I have sinned and sinned. My sins, which pass the Jews in piety. They killed once an inglorious man, but I crucify him daily. For Donne, Jewishness is hidden and insidious, a secret waiting to be unearthed, perhaps intensified by conversos, Jews in Christian disguise, that deepen the worry. Is faith disguisable? Is religious identity a clothing one can assume and discard, a kind of religious transvestism? Think of Jessica's marginalization in Act 5 of The Merchant of Venice in Belmont. The sense that Jewish conversion was not sincere was only heightened by a rise of apocalyptic belief in the imminent conversion of the Jews. And the question of conversion was also a question of national identity. Debates were arising in Protestant areas about what it means to be English or German or Dutch. If Jews can become Christian, they confound notions of racial and national purity and distinctiveness. Can anyone become English? In debates over the Jew Bill of 1753, the question was raised whether foreign Jews can become naturalized British subjects. The Jew Bill was less about the Jews than about the boundaries of Englishness. What makes someone English? Now, some have called this secularization, a transfer of religion to nationalism, no longer the opposition of Christian and Jew, but of Englishman and Jew. But the Christian religious element still remains. And perhaps the most explosive element in The Merchant of Venice is the subtle and often overlooked conversion that takes place in Act 4. Yeah, you can go to the next one. Thanks. And I mean here the conversion not of Jessica, the daughter of Shylock, who converts and runs off with Lorenzo, but rather what happens in the courtroom scene. Portia enters the courtroom expressing the hermeneutical anxiety at the heart of Protestantism. Which the merchant here, and which the Jew? She then delivers her crucial speech, articulating the Christian voice. The quality of mercy is not strained. It droppeth as the gentle rain from heaven upon the place beneath. It is twice blessed. It blesseth him that gives and him that takes. It is an attribute to God himself. Therefore, Jew, and she always calls him Jew, Shylock. Therefore, Jew, though justice be thy plea, consider this. Negotiations continue. Shylock rejects mercy, demands justice, and is about to exercise his right to the bond, a pound of flesh from Antonio, when suddenly Portia's voice, as a kind of messianic salvation, returns. Yes, a pound of flesh, but not a drop of blood. And I ask my students sometimes, how do you read Portia's words? And I find her dripping with sarcasm in this speech. Soft. The Jew shall have all justice. Soft. No haste. He shall have nothing but the penalty. Therefore prepare thee to cut off the flesh. Shed thou no blood, nor cut thou less nor more, but just a pound of flesh. If thou cuttest more or less than a just pound, be it so much as makes it light or heavy in the substance, or the division of the 20th part of one poor scruple. Nay, if the scale do turn but in the estimation of a hair, thou diest and all thy goods are confiscated. So what are we seeing here? Portia, disguised as Balthazar, at this moment becomes the Jew, using Talmudic pilpul to defeat Shylock. The bond calls for a pound of flesh, yes, but not a drop of blood. 1 pound, not a hair more or less. She enacts Christianity's imagined triumphant rabbinic Jew, defeating him on his own legalistic Jewish terms. In Shakespeare's day, this meant, of course, a male actor dressed as a woman, Portia, then dressed in Act 4 as disguised as a man, as a male lawyer. Portia enters with words about Christian mercy, but triumphs over Shylock by Judaizing her argument. Christianity triumphs in defeating and expelling Shylock, but not with Christian mercy, but only through a kind of theological transvestism. Portia turning male physically and Jewish intellectually. Underlying is an uncertainty at the heart of Christianity itself. Jesus, too, is slippery. Was he a Jew or a Christian? When did he switch from one to the other? What marks the distinctiveness of Christianity if it is simply a fulfillment of Jewish messianic expectations? Lording the anxiety is a Christian sense of shame at having originated within Judaism, given the denigrations heaped upon that religion by Christian theologians. Metaphorically speaking, Jesus is theologically intersexed, we might say, neither definitively fully Jewish nor Christian, but easily dressed as one or the other, and this is the Jewish haunting of Christianity. For the 19th century, the question is, what does Christian theology do with shame when historicism becomes the main tool of theological self-definition? On the other hand, hatred of Jews certainly does not always constitute the Christian, and I want to turn briefly to a counterexample from 17th century England, and I'll mention Cotton Mather, who was mentioned earlier today. The historian Richard Codley has identified one group within the millennialist community of 17th century England and New England as Judeo-centrists. While repudiating Judaism, they aspired to a Jewish presence within Christendom and a restoration of a Jewish nation in Palestine or in New England. Samuel Sewall wanted it in Mexico. What the Bible describes really happened, according to this group whom Codley has identified, and it's his term, Judeo-centrists. Theirs is a prehistoricist apologetic in which Judaism is honored. They mitigate troubling passages such as, "His blood be upon us." Of course, they don't represent all of Calvinism. Others in England at the time, such as William Prynne, sounded far worse even than Luther in his worst writings. But it is in sharp distinction from the Protestant tradition that we may be more familiar with from Germany. These Judeo-centrists want Jews to convert, but in so doing, they believe, the Jews will restore the apostolic church and, moreover, explain to Christians the obscure passages of the Bible. Here's an example. There's a pseudonymous text of 1655 called The Resurrection of Dead Bones, nice title, purportedly by someone whose name is given as J.J. Philo Judaeus, an English Calvinist, and it's a kind of counter-theology. He argues here that while the Jews persecuted Jesus, they did so out of ignorance. And in fact, their rejection of Jesus was ultimately a favor to Christians. Quote, "It was for our sakes that they hated Christ, refused the gospel, and became enemies to the truth, that we might be brought to the knowledge of him that is able to save to the utmost." The text goes on to say that the expulsion of the Jews from England in 1290 was a Christian sin, requiring Christian atonement that would come through Jewish readmission to England. And once there, good Christian behavior would encourage the Jews to convert. Now, as Codley has delineated, the author was supported in most of these arguments by a host of other theologians, John Dury, Increase Mather, Robert Matten, Moses Wall, Edward Nicholas, and Cotton Mather, and even Roger Williams and Samuel Sewall. These Judeo-centrists saw Messianic Christianity leading to the restoration of a Jewish national state in Palestine and assumed that this was also a yearning of the Jews themselves. They believed the Jews remain God's chosen people, in opposition to the traditional Christian supersessionism of the amillennialists, who rejected the belief in a future kingdom on earth and who claimed that Jewish chosenness had been revoked with their rejection of Jesus. So we might ask, what motivates Judeo-centrism, since we worry so much about the anti-Semites? What motivates them? Contemporary debates over readmission of the Jews was one factor. Even more was the sense that the kingdom was fast approaching, and with the arrival of the millennium, the Jews would no longer be under the sentence of exile that God had imposed. And of course, we hear echoes of this theological Judeo-centrism of the 17th century to this day among premillennial dispensationalists, among Christian Zionists. This English theological tradition is worth keeping in mind when we try to understand how we can shape a positive Christian appreciation for Judaism. Of course, one that is not prehistoricist, clearly, and one that is not necessarily millennialist. And I want to turn now briefly to the historicist tradition of liberal Protestantism that exerted such an important impact on Jewish thought in 19th century Germany. I've written about historicism and about its impact on Protestant-Jewish relations, particularly in terms of the political undertones that shape the historical arguments that I've defined in terms of post-colonial theory. So Christian supersessionism is a form of theological colonialism, and Jewish scholarship on Christian origins as a reversal of the gaze or revolt of the colonized. But today I want to draw attention to two additional problems that affect both Jewish and Protestant theology in the modern period. First, that conversionary anxieties continue as historians try to analyze precisely when Jesus became a Christian, when Christianity separated from Judaism, how Jewish teachings became transformed into Christian teachings, if they ever did. And second, I want to ask with you if historicism actually offered a new paradigm or simply confirmed inherited theological paradigms. And for this, I want to return to my title, my lecture, Is God a Virgin? I won't ask you to vote one way or the other on this. I wonder if you wondered, why is she making that a title and where does that come from? But I'll tell you where it comes from. Is God a virgin? This is the question haunting 19th century Protestant scholarship on Christian origins. So when Gustav Folkmar, and I'll tell you in a moment who he was, when Gustav Folkmar declared, Christianity is born of the virgin womb of the God of Judaism, he was hoping to overcome the shame of origins by declaring that Christianity was the firstborn of God, not derived from Judaism, nor even born of the same womb as Judaism. Folkmar made the claim in the midst of the Tudian school's conversionary anxiety over determining the boundaries between the Jewish followers of Jesus and Christianity. Just how much Judaism had those Jewish followers, whom they named Jewish Christians, a term that's not in the Church Fathers, how much Judaism had they brought into the Christian realm? When was Christianity, early on, cleansed of this Jewish influence to emerge as the Church? When did the Church actually become an independent entity, independent of Judaism? Note that the paradigm, and soon became a common trope of Protestant theology, Christianity took the first 200 years to purify itself of Jewish accretions. Virginity is a metaphor for who is in and who is out, writes the contemporary English theologian Stephen Pattison. I think it's a great line. Virginity is not only about God or about women, it's about politics as well. Neither the land we now call the United States nor the land of Israel, for example, were virgin soils. My teacher, the late Uriel Tal, made clear in his superb study that liberal Protestants and liberal Jews in Germany began preaching the same message, so that the difference between the two religions became blurred, leading, he argued, to polemic as a tool of distinction. I know it's warm in this room. I'm sorry. Does any, if you want to open a window, are you warm? Is anybody else warm, or am I the only one who's warm? Yeah, where is the ventilation? Fresh air of Jerusalem we want. Yeah. Thank you. And, well, Walter, she put her coat down or something. All right. In his book, Sundays at Sinai, Tobias Bringman pointed out that Christians as well as Jews flocked to Sinai Temple in Chicago to hear the sermons of Rabbi Emil Hirsch, a reform rabbi. The message was the same, but who had the idea first? Jewish thinkers, starting with Mendelssohn, insisted that there was nothing new or original in the message of Jesus, and Christian scholars responded with evidence from the ancient Near East demonstrating precursors to Old Testament ideas and practices. Jewish scholars insisted that Judaism was autochthonous. Always wondered why they insisted. And they loved to claim that Judaism was the mother religion, Christianity and Islam, the daughter religions. And Israel Yuval, you have wonderful examples of that in your book, the use of that trope over and over. And from the Jewish point of view, the mother, yes, said to the daughters bring Jewish monotheism as handmaidens to the pagans, Greeks and Arabs. Indeed, I was drawn to my study of Abraham Geiger not only for the brilliance of his arguments, but for the cleverness of his arguments. The faith of Jesus was liberal Pharisaic religion, later lost in rabbinic legalism because of the pressures of Christian oppression of Jews, but revived this liberal Pharisaic religion by liberal Judaism in the 19th century, suggesting that Christians wanting the faith of Jesus ought to become Reformed Jews. Jewish responses to Protestantism in the 19th century blossomed. It was an era of Jewish theology that was quite extraordinary. But considering Jewish responses to Protestantism or Protestant influences on Judaism means not only looking at written texts. As Sandra Gilman and also Tariq El-Aris have argued, modernity is also a somatic condition, a condition of the body. For example, the oral dimension of hearing an organ in the synagogue, the visual appearance of a rabbi in the pulpit dressed in talar and beshin, just like a minister, the regulation of how the body shuckles and moves in prayer, or doesn't, or shouldn't. We think of affect, the new rules not to demonstrate passion during prayer by calling out amen or singing with a chazan, but holding it in. And perhaps the underlying sense of self, as Amos Finkelstein wrote, the problem for Jews became that they lost the sense of being in exile. And I would add, they also lost the sense of being colonized subjects of European regimes. These are dimensions that have been called assimilation or Christianization, but that I would rather interpret in Homi Bhabha's terms, in his understanding of hybridity and mimicry in the colonialist setting. By hybridity, he means hybridity challenges assumptions of cultural imperviousness and claims instead that the boundaries of self and nation and culture are much more fluid and porous than suggested by the term otherness. Hybridity suggests also a lack of cultural purity. Even as Jews were assimilating into a Christian world, through their mimicry and hybridity, they were challenging and also subverting Christianity's supersessionist authority by claiming key elements of Christianity as actually Judaism's own. The Christian reaction to Jewish subversionary activity was not positive. Historical research reconstructed first century Palestine, but ultimately it presented Judaism as degenerate and Jesus as superior. So this is the question about historicism. Did it change the paradigm? What Emil Schurer wrote in his multi-volume famous study on first century Palestine and Jesus and the emergence of Christianity, but Emil Schurer wrote, despite his brilliance in research, is striking because his conclusions about the misery of Jewish life in his notorious chapter, Life Under the Law, his conclusions are hardly different from those of an ignorant village pastor. And he's but one example of hundreds. Older theological models were not overcome, and historicism functioned to reinforce rather than challenge theological commitments. A change in tone does come in the 20th century, but moving in several different directions. Emancipation achieved, Jews were now turning inward and eastward, fascinated by piety, mysticism, Orientalism. Jewish thinkers now sought ways to detach Judaism from Christianity. Islam was the preferred partner. Jewish scholars founded the field of Islamic studies and delighted in demonstrating the parallels between rabbinic texts and the Quran. Some translated the Quran into German, French, and Hebrew, and others taught at Muslim institutions. Jews called Islam ethical monotheism, even as they called Judaism ethical monotheism. Hermann Cohen, in his later work, rejected much of the rationalist theology of the 19th century, but also rejected the turn to the newly popular irrational of Orientalism and mysticism. Judaism possessed religion, whereas Christians came to it, he wrote, only through, quote, the high price of concessions to the spirit and practices of paganism. The religion closest to Judaism and its monotheism, Cohen wrote, was Islam. Jews, for Cohen, sought the synthesis of Judaism and Germanness. But for him, Germanness was the high culture of the Enlightenment. What the Protestant Reformation accomplished, according to Cohen, was a long-needed effort to rid Christianity, finally, of Teutonic paganism. Of course, anti-pagan rhetoric in modern Jewish thought mimicked the anti-Judaism of Christian theology and served as a crucial Jewish apologetic against the historicism of Babel and Bebel and similar claims of ancient Near Eastern scholars. Hermann Cohen was prescient, perhaps perceiving the revival of Teutonic paganism as a tool of the anti-Christian and anti-Semitic rebellion that grew in Germany in the 1920s and 30s. random pastors called for eliminating the Old Testament as a Jewish book that had no place in the Christian Bible, and suggested that Jesus wasn't a Jew after all, he was an Aryan. The First World War was a funnel for such ideas, so that by the 1920s, these were not obscure or marginal, but very much on the agenda, even among those who were not part of the growing radical right-wing nationalist movements. The Third Reich provided the crucial framework for institutionalizing a formal process within the Protestant Church to de-Judaize Christianity. And I've written about this, how they formed an institute in 1939 and 1945, and published their own version of the New Testament, purged of all Jewish references. They got rid of the Old Testament, they had a hymnal, and they eliminated words such as hallelujah. They had trouble getting rid of amen because people were so reflexively used to saying amen, but they wanted to. They had conferences, publications, learned papers, not learned papers, professors, bishops, pastors, religion teachers, laity. They celebrated their institute's formation on the Wartburg in May of 1939. And they had many, many conferences to try to figure out how to get rid of everything Jewish from Christianity. But what I found so striking looking at the documents was that at their meetings, what did they talk about? What's Jewish? And so they spent most of the time talking about the Jewish instead of getting rid of it. I've called this a form of theological bulimia. So what does Aryan Christology mean in light of folkish nationalism? God permeates the German people and elevates them to a folk, a category in some way analogous to Christ, a folk that would carry out Jesus' own mission of destroying the Jews, they felt, in the Nazi period, and exercise vengeance on the Jews for having murdered him. Protestants may believe that without correct methods, God is not found in the Bible, yet sola scriptura unleashed anarchy in Bible interpretations. As Europe engaged in decolonization during the mid-20th century, Christian supersessionism no longer seemed viable. The Second Vatican Council of the Roman Catholic Church paved the way for rethinking Christianity's acceptance of Judaism's continued theological validity. This was in the 1965 document Nostra Aetate, which startled the world and stimulated Protestant engagements in Jewish-Christian dialogue as well. The bond between Jews and the civil rights movement was forged over the prophets and the exodus from Egypt. And my father's relationship with Martin Luther King remains a source of enormous inspiration and yearning for ways to forge alliances across race, religion, gender. And of course, we also have a problem, which is forging alliances within each religion, between liberal and reactionary. By the 1970s, however, liberal Protestantism was supplanted by liberation theology. Religions were coming under attack for universalizing the experiences of white heterosexual men. If God is male, then the male is God, wrote the feminist philosopher Mary Daly. Difference was occluded by such universals, and the challenges posed by African American theologians, Latin American theologians, feminist and womanist theologians, among others, became a further huge blow to the moral integrity and theological coherence of liberal Protestantism. The arguments, I only realized much later, actually picked up on some of the Nazi-era arguments. And Christian will remember the days when we used to talk about liberation theologians who blamed Judaism for Jesus' wonderful liberal message having been suppressed. Yeah, the Jews were so miserable in the first century, and Jesus came and tried to change things and never could, and some of the ugliness associated with those movements of liberation theology. Of course, I think we're all aware that as Zionism, past 1967, was transformed into occupation, the state of Israel from a Jewish nation into a larger administrative power over millions of Palestinians precisely during the era of third world anti-colonial movements of liberation, Jewish-Christian relations were thrown into a new conflict. Accepting the Jewishness of Jesus' message led Protestants to assert that the message was essentially that of Judaism, but applied universally. And that's a very standard message, I hear. Within that universal context, most liberal Protestants could not accept the redefined post-1967 Zionism, especially after it became central to Jewish identity. For the millennialists, heirs to the 17th century English Judeo-centric tradition, Zionism was welcomed, but at the expense of condemning Enlightenment, science, historicism, black and brown people, homosexuality, birth control, abortion, feminism, and always continuing the missionary agenda toward the Jews. Christianity was not abandoned by Jews after the war, but transformed by some Jews into a central resource for expressing Jewish experience. Marc Chagall and Elie Wiesel used the crucifixion to express the horror of Jewish suffering in the Shoah. My father's writings on Jewish religious experience have become central to Protestant and Catholic understandings of their faiths. A very different sensibility is expressed in the famous sardonic photograph by Adi Ness, The Last Supper, the Israeli photographer, that turns an iconic moment of The Last Supper, in some sense, into kitsch. In his photograph, a group of Israeli soldiers are seated at a long table, striking poses in imitation of Leonardo da Vinci's famous painting. He uses this classic Christian scene to militarize, Judaize, and homoeroticize the Christian. The counter-Christian, first developed in the supposedly assimilating or mimicking atmosphere of 19th century German Jewish scholarship, has now reached a pinnacle in the Israeli counterculture and its reorganization of the identities and relationships among Jews, Christians, and Israelis. So to come back to God's virginity. God's virginity is a claim to boundaries, who is in, who is out. Gustav Volkmar's appeal to God's virgin womb was a claim to Christian chosenness and Jewish exclusion. Given the disastrous consequences for women that the very concept of virginity has brought all over the world, to say nothing of its political consequences, whether for American exceptionalism or Zionist exceptionalism, the concept of virginity is certainly troubling. The relationship between Protestantism and Judaism is unique among world religions. Theological conversion between them has often been slippery, and its consequences at times highly problematic. My hope is that this conference of historians and theologians will make clear past problems and future hopes, and that a new metaphor will ultimately supersede Volkmar's divine virginity. I want to say a last word, a personal word. In the 1880s, the word Protestant within the Arab world had degenerated into a term of ridicule and even abuse. There's a joke. One Arab would mock another. "Are you crazy?" The other would answer, "How can I be crazy? Am I a Protestant?" "You people don't laugh at any of my jokes. I have told you so many funny things tonight. What's the matter with you?" Theological bulimia, I usually get a big laugh from that. Okay. This was a new joke I had. Isn't it good, huh? It's a good one, no? Okay. So, am I mad? What, am I a Protestant? Okay. Now, I don't share those feelings. I want to say I have enormous respect for the intellectual vitality of Protestant thought, from Luther to Schleiermacher to Barth and Niebuhr, and I'm deeply grateful for the moral leadership of mainline Protestant denominations in the United States and in Europe that have joined in powerful coalition with the Jewish majority of Americans on issues facing African Americans, women, LGBTQ, and against the death penalty, nuclear power, war, and environmental degradation. But I want to say, today's challenges feel very dire. Democracy is under threat. Autocracy is slouching toward Bethlehem. My father wrote on the first page of God in Search of Man that modern science and philosophy are not to blame for the decline of religion. He says, quote, "Religion declined not because it was refuted, but because it became irrelevant, dull, oppressive, insipid." Today I worry that the message we hear from religious leaders is far worse than insipid. That we've turned our backs on the greatest voice of moral authority that we possess, the prophets of the Hebrew Bible. Those who claim they speak in the name of God, protecting national borders, deporting good people, as is going on this weekend in the United States, wanting a white Christian America that will supposedly make the country great. I fear we are witnessing truth and justice covered with chains. We see selfishness and the lust for power and wealth, domination rather than peace, ethno-nationalism rather than cultural pluralism, walls rather than welcomes. I fear corruption at the highest political levels, and you know here in this country what I mean. Government not for the people, but for private gain. So we have to ask ourselves, how do we protect our conscience, our judgment, and stimulate our duty as citizens and say no? Say no to the subversiveness of a government that may ruin the values we cherish by carrying out destructive policies. I ask myself, is America, is democracy, the great rock of ages, to become simply a temporary moment in history? A study was done recently by Yasha Mungit at Harvard in the government department, finding that support for the concept of democracy has declined precipitously around the world, including the United States. So let us not think, we who are Jews, that we will be an exception to these white supremacists. Let us not sell our Jewish heritage to people who close the doors to refugees just because we stand on this side of the wall. A people without a conscience is a people that has already moved over to the Sidra Achra, a people that's lost its heritage. So I want to say to you in conclusion that I here as an American, a Jew, a citizen of this world, that my spirit is very heavy right now. My mood is with the prophet Jeremiah, who was witness to exile and destruction. And I quote his words right now. "For among my people are found wicked men. They know no bounds in deeds of wickedness. They judge not with justice the cause of the fatherless, the rights of the needy. Shall I not punish them for these things, says the Lord? And shall I not avenge myself on a nation such as this? An appalling and horrible thing has happened in the land. The prophets prophesy falsely, and the priests rule at their direction. My people love to have it so. But what will you do when the end comes?" I ask myself, do we have resources in our religious traditions to find hope in this time which feels so despairing? And I hope that we will always remember that in our Bible, which we have both as Christians and Jews, as Protestants and Jews, that the central teaching of the Bible is compassion, and that the ultimate expression of God is not wisdom or magnificence or land or glory, not even love, but rather justice. Justice is the tool of God, the manifestation of God, the means of our redemption, and it is also the means of redeeming God from human mendacity. So I say to you, this is an academic conference, but I've taken the liberty of saying a few religious words at the end because I feel that these are very, very serious times that call for it. And I thank you very much, my friends. It's good to be with you.
First of all, thank you for thank you for profoundly depressing us, first of all. I don't have a question, but I had, while you were talking, and I was thinking about something more positive to think of, I was thinking of an exhibition which is going on at the moment at the Israel Museum, Jesus and Jewish in Israeli Art. And I was thinking that everybody should go and see it, because it's very interesting that Israeli painters and sculptors have used Jesus in a very independent way. And I was thinking this while you were talking, and the last image that is shown in the exhibition is actually this painting. So if you have the time, you should go and visit to cheer up
What's
a little
your
bit.
Name?
Alex van der Heijden.
Thank you. Yes, I've heard about the exhibit and I would like to go. James Snyder has been a great director of the Israel Museum. Okay, shall I give you a question and ask me? Okay. Alan.
Two very, very trivial points. The question of that turning point, when does the Jew become a Christian? There's a wonderful plaque in a church in Rome where Alphonse, I believe it was Alphonse, I don't know which of the two brothers is, Ratisbon, saw the Virgin Mary, following which he became Christian. And the plaque says, this is where Alphonse Ratisbon saw the Virgin. He fell to the ground, Jewish. He rose a Christian. So that it captures in a very suggestive way that point of turning, where that fall itself that becomes the moment, which is of course, and I remember when we first saw that, we were totally flabbergasted by it. I had a meeting that day with Cardinal Chegaray, and I was all upset, and I said, look at this, I mean, this has to be changed. He said, oh, we don't think that way anymore nowadays. So it's just a little way of showing. A second point that occurred to me when we were citing Schur, could it be that there's a change within the period you described? Because you're covering a period of, well, you covered a period of about 150 years roughly, but certainly, you know, within, from mid-18th century to earlier, to mid-19th century to early 20th century. I wonder if there isn't a change between the presentation of Judaism as a source from which we come to the denigration of Judaism as a lower form of religion, that Christianity comes as a superior form. I believe that's actually a much end. That's an end of 19th century move, rather than some of those earlier figures that you were citing.
Good. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks. Yes.
You spoke of historicism as a I wonder whether there's not an important connection between historicism and liberalism, and I don't mean by that economic or political liberalism, but theological liberalism. Now, I think there's a very simple equation, which is if you believe in the divinity of Christ, Jesus is already something so special that you don't actually need to bend over backwards to turn Second Temple Judaism into a negative foil. The more you go with the historical Jesus and want him to be like you and I, just better morally. Now the question arises, well, how do you contrast him sufficiently to his environment? And that, of course, leads you into territory where really you need to charge the negativity of Second Temple Judaism or Spät Judentum in a way that you don't if you're a doctrinally firm Orthodox Protestant. So I think that's something worth thinking about.
Absolutely. But that's what this shift, when we go from the faith of Jesus rather than the religion about Jesus. So the getting rid of the supernaturalism and coming up with the man, the biography of the man. That's when we have a certain set of problems. So the liberalism in itself entails this kind of a kind of seesaw, we might say, of what you're pointing to. And of course, it's out of the Tübingen school. Volkmar was a part of this Tübingen school that actually shifted attention away from the figure of Jesus, even though it was a school for New Testament scholarship, and to the construction of the New Testament. So different texts of the New Testament then were the products of early Christianity, representing either a Jewish Christian point of view or a Gentile Christian point of view. And these two points of views, these tendencies, were identified by the Tübingen school, one side or the other, and it was out of their conflict that eventually the church emerged. But in some sense, Jesus himself gets lost in that. And they were cautious not to say it too explicitly. But then came the student of Ferdinand Christian Bauer, David Friedrich Strauss, and in 1835 he published his Life of Jesus, and that was the end of his academic career. It was a scandal. So he stated the real conclusions lying behind it. So we're just saying, though, that of course the construct that eventually dominated the Tubingen school, which flourished from the 1830s through the, say, 1860, was their ability to turn to Schelling, to have him, to give them a kind of construct of world history in which Christianity has a transcendent function. But that's part of the corporeality or the carnality of Jesus that dominates Protestantism. Yeah.
I mean, the direction I was thinking in was simply that, in a way, the more liberal Protestants are, the more likely they are to be interested in this world.
Yes.
And the more likely they are to be open for coalitions that are worried about justice and things like that. And yet, of course, also the more likely they are to have a problematic relationship to Judaism. Whereas your mainstream Orthodox Lutheran will probably have learned their stuff, depending on how well educated they are, but will also have a revulsion against natural theology, and there will be problems there with getting them into the sorts of coalitions we want to get them into. Do you see what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
That's sort of the problem I'm thinking about.
I think the response, the classic responses are two. One is to say Jesus was, I'm a historian, but Jesus was unique. So of course, unique doesn't work if you are a historian in that sense. And what was unique? His religious consciousness. He had a unique religiosity. That's what they claim. Yeah, okay, they conceded to the Jews that his message was nothing original or new. He said nothing new. Okay, but his consciousness. And then by the end of the century, they said, well, racially he was unique. He was an Aryan, not a Jew. Or they say, yes, it's true, his message was nothing different, it's a Jewish message, but it was for everybody, it was universal, whereas the Jews limited only to Jews. And you probably know Boyarin's article about that, but yeah. Yes? Oh, Avital.
Thank you. It was very inspiring, and I love your metaphor, of course, about virginity, and I just wanted to suggest that it's a very good question if God is a virgin, but maybe we can think to expand this metaphor to the body of society itself. And in this way, we can use the metaphor on both sides. So not only the Christians can imagine themselves as virgin, because we're talking now about the society, how fragile it is, how its borders are penetrable. And the text that you brought from Shylock made me thought that Christian society itself feel that it needs to protect its boundaries, but Jewish society as well needs to protect its boundaries so it can imagine itself as a virgin as well.
Yes.
So this metaphor, when we're thinking about the body of society and not only the body of God, we can expand it a little bit more and think about both societies looking at themselves as virgins and afraid of being entered or penetrated from the other society. So
I think you touch on a very important point, and I think it's also illustrated by the let's say, if I may, when Professor Israel Yuval published his book, there was a kind of hysteria to say that Judaism is influenced by Christianity. Why would it make Jews so hysterical? But that illustrates your point about the virginity, doesn't it? Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe I have to change the title of it. Instead of two nations in your womb, two nations in your
virgin
womb.
Exactly.
thank you. To put it maybe a little bit simplistic, I think you sketched maybe two main traditions in modern Protestantism, which the first one tends towards the New Testament. It is liberal, but then it rejects Judaism as some kind of archaic influence, like since the Enlightenment and even earlier. And the other one is more tends toward includes of the Old Testament. It's millenarist and fundamentalist, but then it is non-liberal, and it is it? I mean, so what I wonder, and this is maybe a relevant question, and just to add something, it seems that once at least Judaism tried to chase the liberal tradition of Christianity, and now it had some kind of bond, or at least part of Judaism, especially here in Israel, with the fundamentalist Old Testament branch. Yes. So, is there a third way?
Yes.
I mean, historically, I don't know. Not necessarily.
No, I've often thought, what would it be like for me as a Jew to write a Protestant theology, a Christian theology? It would be nice to do that. Is there a third way? No, seriously, I think that there, first of all, I think it's a relatively new question, just to be fair.
Yeah.
It's really post-World War II.
Yeah.
People are beginning to realize, to think about it. Friedrich Wilhelm Marquardt, the late Protestant theologian in Germany, tried to come up with a Christology that was not anti-Jewish. People have been making attempts how to interpret in a new way. But really, that Marquardt is 70s, 80s, 90s. It's all relatively new. I think we will move in that direction, and I certainly hope so. I would say, though, of course, that I cut a lot of my talk. I had wanted to talk a bit about Rosenzweig and his great essay, Atheistic Theology, where he talks about the figure of Jesus and the collective Jewish people, and he draws certain parallels of how Jesus is treated, how the Jewish people construct themselves in 19th century thought. In problematic ways, including divinizing ourselves, and he writes also against Zionism in that article. But so I would just say that we also have problems. It's not just that the Protestants have a problem with anti-Judaism. Of course, we have problems too in our tradition. So the kind of theological effort that you're talking about engages all of us.
Yeah, these are actually two kinds of Judaism as well.
Yeah. Yes, thank you.
Thank you for a fascinating talk. This might be shifting a little bit to your current research, but I hope it will still be related. Well, you spoke today also about this sort of German-Jewish scholarly fascination with Islam, and that it was a certain response to Christianity or Christian scholarship. And I was wondering, speaking about the Christian-Jewish relations today, is there anything left of this kind of fascination?
The kind of rhetoric against Islam that I hear in the United States, that I'm sure you're familiar with, I didn't hear in the 19th century. There's certainly Jewish thinkers who didn't like Islam, but they didn't talk about it in those terms. When Jews were writing about Islam, they saw the passages that are violent in the Quran, but that wasn't their primary concern. Of course, political situation has changed entirely, and that shaped scholarship, and I think we have to acknowledge that our scholarly interests are also an effect of our culture and our political situation. We try in some way to minimize it and to keep ourselves on an intellectual track, but there are foundations with multi-million dollar foundations that have a political agenda and that fund Jewish scholarship if it goes in such a right-wing agenda, it follows that path. That's very damaging to the integrity of what we're trying to do as academics, it's clear. And beyond that, so is there something comparable today? I don't really think so. I do think, though, that there is an important tradition of Jewish scholarship on Islam that continues, especially in Israel, but also in the United States, and that does continue what I think is a very great heritage from the 19th century, from Europe, of Jews who founded a field of Islamic studies at a time when Christians were interested in India because they wanted to find the origins of the Aryan soul. And the Jews wanted to do something else. And they did it, out of interest, out of desire, out of admiration, out of love, out of enjoyment, out of pleasure, what every scholar does, out of pleasure. Why would you sit and translate the Quran into German or into Hebrew? No one's, it's not a bestseller. You don't do it for the money. You don't do it for the prestige. You do it because there's a passion inside of you. And that's what drives a scholar. Right? Yes?
This is just, if you want to say any more about the uncomfortable, the part that made us all feel uncomfortable, which is the political part, which is the, in many ways an incredibly important, if not maybe the most important part right now, which is, do you want to say any more? I mean, we're constrained in these dialogues of what we can do at a podium. Was there more that you wanted to say about our contemporary responsibilities as historians and theologians and scholars and Jews and Protestants and other identities?
Mm-hmm. I teach in an American university. We have various elite students, Ivy League University and so on. And I think I have now very strong, sober feeling about what is going to have to happen when I go back to my classroom at the end of March when I'm going to be teaching with Professor Yuval, who's coming. I think I'm all of a sudden taking it much more seriously than I ever have. I've often wondered in the past, what are the moral values I want to convey? And what are the values of scholarship? Because a classroom is a room where students have the only opportunity to learn what it is to be a scholar, and that's something very special. And that is, in fact, a moral commitment. Beyond that, I have to say that the universities in the United States seem to me to be the most important single institution as such in the land where one discusses issues of race, racism, of political discrimination, and so forth. So it is a very important obligation that we have, I feel, that I have, that in my classroom, these are issues that are going to be discussed. What can I do to bring about change as such? Of course, there are limitations that I'm not, I read, I listen, I try to do what others suggest. But I don't have a formula. But I think it is a very disturbing time, of course. And I think anybody who's also written about the Nazi era finds certain parallels that are terribly upsetting. And I think any Jew who's haunted by family and what happened to family, of course, it has a very emotional impact when we hear the White House issue a statement about the Holocaust. It doesn't mention Jews and antisemitism. It's terrifying. And when I see Jews voting for someone like that and supporting him, for what? I mean, what is it to be a Jew? I don't know. I went to an Orthodox synagogue in Boston recently to hear a lecture, and I was talking with a rabbi, and I was dressed properly, and I had a hat. And he said, we talked a little bit, and then he said to me, well, you're probably a Democrat. And I was startled, and I realized that for some Jews, that's what it is to be a Jew. What happened to an Orthodox rabbi? You should worry about my neshama. Are you Shomer Shabbos? Are you daven with kavana or something? And he said, you're a Democrat. I said, I'm not really a Jew. And there has been a politicization of Jewish identity that's very upsetting. It's very scary to me. And I think also, it not only does it exclude me, does it exclude really the majority of humanity, but I also wonder, what are you going to do when the end comes? You think you're safe? You JDL people, whatever, with Richard Spencer, he says he's a white Zionist, and you think you're safe? Haven't we learned all, what have we been teaching all these years? Okay, let me just say one last, anybody else want to ask me? I'm going to say one other thing. All right, go ahead.
One thing, you brought to see, to us, Adinez, there is the American Israeli artist Marsha Rubin, and she has done a similar picture with women, and it's called Knitting Fate. And you see the women knitting. And I think, for me, it's become also a symbol of that's been particularly meaningful today, because I see us as, you know, we all, whether we're male or female or something else yet, we are knitting fate. So this image by Martha Rubin has become, which you can see in the Israel Museum, has become very meaningful.
That's so interesting. That's great. Thanks for telling me. Can I just say one last word about Luther, just for a moment? Because one of my teachers was Van Harvey, who who wrote a fantastic book on Feuerbach, Lars von Mosnoy. And one of the things that he finds in some of Feuerbach's later writings, Feuerbach says that he read Luther as confirmation that theology is anthropology. That's his quote, Feuerbach. And that faith is the product of wish fulfillment. So that for Feuerbach, Luther is actually the father of atheism. And Ben Harvey has written about this, and I think it's also an important point that I didn't include when I gave the talk, but to realize the multitude of dimensions of readings, that a text can be read in so many different ways, and even a figure such as Luther can be read by a brilliant philosopher like Feuerbach in this very different manner. The possibilities that are opened up sometimes feel anarchic, and I think that's why it's also our obligation as scholars to keep our moral center. Yeah. So, thank you so much.